Nazrin, and I'd like to welcome everyone to the session. Let's check out who is here. How do I see who is here? We have Dr. Mira, hello. We have Dr. Farida, Dr. Farah, Dr. Antini, Dr. Hairul, Dr. Nur Azrul Azam. I apologize for mangling all of your names. Dr. Nurul, Dr. Sibajini, and of course Nurul and Dr. Vignesh. Hello everyone and welcome to the session. We're going to be running a topic called People Drive, How to Empower People. And I would prefer this to be a two-way conversation, because why? The best way for me to understand how I can help you is if I understand what situations, what issues, what challenges, what problems you face. So, and of course, I'm over here alone. All I can see is my bedroom. I can't see any of you. I don't know what's happening over there. So I would love for us to have a conversation through the text chat. So let's try this out a little bit, right? I would like everyone to type in what they had for breakfast this morning, just so I know that you're actually sitting there and you're ready to go. So I'm going to type in what I had breakfast, which is, well, still waiting for it to come. How about everyone else? Let's see what pops up in the text chat. Umu, what do you, please join in as well. So what did you have for breakfast? Vignesh, yeah, thank you. Sama lah kita. How about anyone else? Nasi lemak, okay, that makes me jealous. If you want nasi lemak, and I'm not bragging, rawang in Bandar Country Homes has the highest concentration of different types of nasi lemak ever. There's so many vendors here that if I actually joked with my wife, and it's turning to become not a joke anymore. I seriously want to run a nasi lemak festival with a nasi lemak competition, and all of these vendors will come in and compete, because it's varied, it's super varied. Okay, almost says about to eat nasi goreng during my session. Nasi lemak is like standard Malaysian fare lah, Dr. Azam. Cukodok pisang. Pagi-pagi, okay, that makes me even more jealous. How about everyone else? Dr. Amira, I know you're there. What did you have for breakfast this morning? Seriously? Okay, yeah, when I travel out of Rawang to do client training in KL, usually that's the fastest. It sort of tells me this is weird, man. Why are people not picking up on the speed that McDonald's has in providing breakfast, because people are rushing out to go to work. All they can do is pick up stuff. So I'm thinking, if you have a WhatsApp number where you can order for breakfast tomorrow morning, and all you have to do is just pass by a gerai and just pick it up, right? That would be awesome. Only challenge, of course, I guess, because you'd have to pass by Malaysian roads, you drive on the left side, which means that you would need to open up your left window and we'll drop it in. Okay, nasi lemak and McD chicken, ayam. Oh, okay. Tell me, Dr. Azam, is it pedas tak? Because the last time I tried it, the sambal is ridiculously pedas. This is something that I cannot been able to figure out about McDonald's. It's just weird. Is it okay for you? Because I tried it a couple of days ago and it's not sangat-sangat pedas. That's okay, doctor. We're not looking for a verbal conversation in as much as we want to see that you're there. So what did you have for breakfast? McDonald's? Cool. Thank you very much, everyone. So the reason I asked you about breakfast is because Malaysians are very well known for being driven by food. And that's a drive that is unique to a lot of people. When they come to Malaysia, all my colleagues who are overseas, they say, why do you people eat so much? Every time we have a meeting, okay, you tell me in UM, right? Is it standard fare every time there's a meeting, there will always be kuih, kuih and coffee? The Americans are weirded out. They will ask, do you want coffee or not? But in Malaysia, they don't ask. It's there. It is already there, ready to go. In fact, the only meetings where there are no food are when I meet with international people. Which seems a bit strange now that I think about it, because I'm so used to having meetings in Malaysia with food, paling kurang, and they always say it's like makanan ringan-ringan, but then you look at it, and it's mee goreng or it's nasi goreng, it's mee siam or things like that, and you wonder, why do people do this? Well, I have not been able to track the history of it, but it does relate to our topic in that many people are driven by different things. And it gets to be challenging, especially if you have staff, especially if you have students, especially if you have family members who you're trying to motivate, you're trying to get them to be able to be better at something, whether it be, you know, better behaviors or better performance or better knowledge. The challenge that humanity has faced from the very beginning is, how do we influence, how do we persuade, how do we convince another human being? We know how to do it to ourselves, but how do we do it to someone else? So this has been the forte of teachers, trainers, presenters, salespeople, leaders, parents for the longest time. And interestingly, we still have not figured it out, because why? The human brain is so complex. So as much as human knowledge can get us here, I always say that 10, 15 years from now, whatever we learn today will be different, will be more exact, will be more useful, especially since the human being changes every single day. But today, for today, I'm going to show you a model that will help you to understand people quickly and then motivate them. I don't like to use the word motivate. I want to use the word influence them. Influence them to move in a particular direction of their own choice, so that they motivate themselves, so that they take responsibility for what they want to do. So today's topic is how to empower people. And in as little a time as 3 hours, I will do my best to get that across. Now, I need your feedback. I need your help. Because we're working online and because we are blind to what is being received by other people at this time, if you cannot hear me, if the connection goes bad, if I am breaking up, please tell me in the chat, right? Because I will not know. So I will ask you for this for help. Please tell me in the chat whenever something goes down or whenever you cannot hear me. All right, here we go. First question of the day is, I want everyone in the room to give me an answer to this, okay? How would you motivate people? And this is not a test. I'm not asking for a right or wrong answer. I'm asking for your answer. I really would like to learn, because sometimes I get some really good answers, some good insights from leaders, from lecturers, people who do this on a daily basis. So please, I'm going to give you 3 minutes. How many people are in the room? There's about 10 people in the room now. Please tell me, how do you motivate people, whether it be your children, whether it be your family members, whether it be your students or your colleagues or your subordinates, okay, or your bosses? How would you motivate them? I'll give you 3 minutes to tell me in the text chat, and then we'll have a simple discussion on that. Thank you. Umu says, leading by example. Dr. Aaron says, give a morning wish to motivate them. That's a good one. Good morning, everyone. Right. Not give them nasi lemak. Okay, how about everyone else? Are you thinking about how you motivate people? Like I said, there's no right or wrong answer. We would love to know what you do. So we have 2 answers so far. I'm looking forward to see what else. For my family, give them a kiss and hug. Okay, thank you. By acknowledging and appreciating their good work, that's good. What else do we have? So I'm going to stay silent for about 30 seconds because I know you're typing, and then we'll see what pops up. Thank you, Dr. Vignesh. So I didn't know you could do this. So you can actually like people's comments. Oh, cool. Okay, thank you very much. So now, let's see, I'm going to ask Dr. Hairul, would you do me the favor of turning on your microphone and then share with me why do you do this and how do you do this in a bit more detail?
Hi, Dr.
Hi, good morning. So the question will be why? Why do you do this?
Oh, why I do this? It's actually very simple for me to do this, and it's mean a lot for people. For example, giving a kiss of heart to my family, my kid, my wife. It's something quite simple but very meaningful for them. And for my colleague, my student, can motivate them by give a morning wish from the poster through WhatsApp or Telegram. They appreciate much and they feel refreshed during morning. So these are simple things that we can do to motivate people. Sometimes when people are down, we can say to them, sometimes you cannot get all whatever you want, but we need to appreciate whatever we have. That is more important.
Okay. My next question is this. When somebody does it to you, do you like it?
Sure. I appreciate it. Why do you do the same thing to me?
Okay, good. So the thing is this with everyone, guys. There are many ways of motivating people. If you did not go for a training program or a course on how to do this, usually what we do is we treat people the same way we want to treat us. So, Dr. Hairul, I suspect, and this can be a good thing, I suspect that you treat people that way because you want people to treat you that way. Is that correct?
Yes, agreed. Right. I always say to my student, if you want people to appreciate you, you need to learn to how appreciate people.
Good.
Then you will get whatever you give back.
And when you appreciate people, what do you appreciate? How do you appreciate them? You say good morning. That's more of having acknowledging that they exist, and then wanting them to have a good morning. What else do you do with your students? Let's say your students, because you don't hug your students, I think.
Yeah, the simple thing you can do is to say thank you for whatever they did. Try to ignore whatever the anything that you don't like.
Okay.
Focus on what you think is good, have meaningful value, then you appreciate that.
There we have one. Thank you for that, Doctor. Because you know why? What you mentioned is something very, very critical. Ignore, I know you're like, should I say this or not? Ignore the things that you don't like.
Yeah.
And focus on the things that you do like. Yes. So I love this because since the early 2000s, I know a lot of you know this, but I'm going to say it anyway. There has been a movement in strength psychology, which talks about focus more on building people's strengths rather than trying to fix their weaknesses.
Yeah.
Because everybody is different. Everybody is wired differently. We have different talents. We have different strengths. So if someone has a particular strength in one area, then what you do is you help them magnify that to such an extent that their weaknesses no longer become weaknesses. So I like what you said, because a lot of people out here, if you notice, when they do something good, nobody says anything. But when they do something bad, tiba-tiba kena marah, kan?
Betul.
And this is not just from parents, this is from bosses as well. Bosses never seem to see the good, they only see the bad.
The excuse is,
I pay you salary, so I have a right to do this to you. But then what it does is, it doesn't motivate people, it demotivates people. So I will share with you, jumping off Dr. Hairul punya very good tip, did you learn this from somewhere, or is it something that you picked up on, or you believe it's something good, so you practiced it?
I believe and I learned from the experience. So.
Okay, so learning from experience means that you are an expert, because experience, expert kan? What you just shared comes from a book. So I did not learn it from experience. I learned it from a book. And this is a very thin book. Anybody who's heard of, you know, Who Moved My Cheese? So there was a trend of very thin books, management books, for managers who don't have time to read. So there is one book I will recommend if you're interested in this topic even further, it's called the 1 Minute Manager. Oh. Have you seen this one?
1 Minute Manager.
Okay, so for everyone, it's the 1 Minute Manager, and every page is a very powerful tip. And Dr. Hyrule's tip is there in the form of this. Catch people doing good. Right? Catch people doing good. Everybody please write that down, because for me, it changed how I do things with people. We always catch people doing bad things, right? No, you catch people doing good. And when you can catch people doing good, what happens is you reinforce that behavior. I'll give you a simple example. My son is sleeping right here. But I'll give you a simple example. There was one time after I read the book, we went to the pasar, as we often do on the weekends. So the wet market has two floors. The ground floor is where all the pasar actually is. Second floor is where the food stalls are. It is where, you know, when my wife goes to the pasar downstairs, I go upstairs with my kids and wait for her there. So we would order nasi lemak and stuff like that and munch until she comes. There was one day when I gave my son a bottle of Yakult, and there was nothing on the table, you know, there was nothing on the table yet except for that bottle of Yakult. Then I was reading the newspaper, and he was struggling to open that bottle of Yakult with a straw. Suddenly, it just burst open. I want you to imagine the whole table just suddenly is full of Yakult, right? And you can see his face. His face turns to horror. He's like, and I looked at him. I looked at that, and I just continued reading the newspaper. I just continued, and you can see him a little confused. So what I did was I just folded the newspaper. We found some tissue, wiped up the Yakult. I gave him another bottle of Yakult. Guess what? What do you think happened? He opened the next bottle much more carefully. So he learned from his own experience, we don't need to tell them they're wrong. They know they're wrong. And the reason for this is, of course, very, very clear. We want our children to grow up, true. We want them to do the right things, true. But we don't reinforce the right things. We only reinforce the wrong things. So when you reinforce the wrong things by scolding them for the wrong things, what naturally happens is they become worried or nervous about the wrong things. If you scold a child for dropping a glass on the floor, the chances of them dropping the glass later again and again and again is higher, because they are no longer confident holding the glass. They become very, very nervous. Now think about this, everyone. This is why when we were students, we panicked when we went to an exam. We worried. Oh, why? Because we've only had negative experiences. We've never had a positive experience with an exam. So every time we meet an exam, we panic, we worry. Every time we do something, performance assessment ke, masa audit ke, we worry. Why? Because it's been ingrained into us to worry about what we cannot control, about what we cannot do. And then what happens? The good suffers, the good behavior suffers. So Dr. Hyrule, thank you very much for that, because you have managed to see it in one point. The whole topic today will be talking about many things, but your point helps a lot to drive that home. Thank you very much. Let's go to Dr. Vignesh. Thank you for your answer. You said by acknowledging and appreciating their good work. So Dr. Vignesh, can you share with me, is this what we were talking about, or is there something else you would like to share with us? Because I cannot assume that what you're saying is what I just said. Can you help me out with, and share with us over the microphone?
Hi, Encik Nazrin. Good morning.
Good morning.
You can call me Vicky.
Can I first say one thing?
Yeah.
You have a fantastic radio voice. I think if you get, ever get invited to radio, please accept it. If they ask you to, I don't know, if BFM invites you, I think you do quite well. So I'm going to say that up front first.
Okay, sadly no one has invited me, but okay, look forward to it.
You asked for it, lah.
Okay, so yeah, of course, now currently I'm heading a department. So when you head a department, you need to, as someone said earlier, you have to lead by example.
Yes.
And of course, every small things that my colleagues do and support the vision or the mission of the department, it of course the name goes to the department, and as me heading the department, of course, I am the first person that anyone will look at. So actually, it's not my work. It is a teamwork, and I have to like give them the support, motivate them, and say all the good things in order to get things done. So as you said, yeah, it's from the book, but at the same time, small things like just saying thank you, even just going and giving a pat at their back and saying, how are you doing today? Those small things also do motivate people.
Thank you very much for that. So my question is, did you learn this, or is this something you also like people to do to you?
Of course, of course, anyone would like to be appreciated. So whenever I deal with things, it is like I tell my people that put yourself in the person's shoe. Good. So because we deal, I'm from the International Student Center, so we deal with a lot of international students. So of course, international students can be difficult dealing with them because they come from various culture background. So when we get issues, you have people behaving in different ways.
Yes.
So of course, being in the Malaysian culture, we have a different way in reacting to them. So this is what I constantly tell them is, whenever you deal with people, just put yourself in their shoe. If you want to be treated that way, then you talk to them rudely or what. If you want yourself to be treated nice, wherever you go, so treat them in the same way.
Thank you very much, Doctor. I studied in IIUM in Gombak, the International Islamic University of Malaysia. So we had 20% to 30% foreign students, I believe, if I remember the number right. And I fully understand where you're coming from, because it was just a mishmash of cultural expectations. The Malaysian students had to learn very quickly how to interact with different body gestures, different body language, different... There were some cultures where you talk to them and they don't show any facial expression at all. It's like, is he listening to me? Is he hearing me? It's just there. So I fully understand where you're coming from. And here's the thing about managing people or leading people. You actually have to know them. If you don't know them, you don't know how to influence them, how to talk to them. Basically, you don't know what they like, right? So there are many, many models out there. One of them I would recommend, a bit weird, I know, but if anyone has heard of the 5 love languages, that is originally designed for couples, originally designed for romantic couples, but it's also good for you to go and take the test. It's called 5 Love Languages, and there's a free test you can take online. It tells you how you like to be appreciated. And if I remember right, some people love to get verbal appreciation. Some people like to get service, right? Service is like, for example, if your husband or your wife does something for you, that means does something for you instead of saying nice things. Okay, they say I don't know how to say nice things. I'm not, but I can get this done for you. So she mends your clothing without telling you. He fixes the car. He sends your car to the workshop without telling you. To sends your car for washing, things like that. But he is not typically expressive in his words. He doesn't say I love you or things like that. So these people, they are more service oriented. There are others who are gift oriented. They like to give you things. So the idea is this: people who have different love languages, they don't realize that they're treating other people the way they want to be treated. And this is why some cross wire between couples sometimes happen. The wife wants to hear nice things, but the husband keeps giving gifts. And then the husband notices she doesn't use the gift, she keeps it, because why, she's waiting for something else. And then the wife says nice things to the husband, but the husband doesn't respond because he expects gifts. That's his love language. So again, there are many psychometric tests or things like that out there you can use. For appreciation, I would recommend 5 love languages. Try that one out. And then after you do the test, or after you study it a little bit, you can sort of guess what your staff are like. Some of them, they want to thank them. There's one way there. You say thank you, their face doesn't change. They go, no thank you back, Vicky, nothing. It's like, So then you can probably guess, this love language is not verbal. Yeah, it must be something else. So you if you know your staff well, sooner or later you'll figure out what they want. Some people want touch. Okay, a bit sensitive, especially when it comes to male-female interactions. But some people like you to touch them, tap them on the shoulder, and then say good job, and you see their face light up, because their love language is like that. How do you detect people like this? They do it to you. When they appreciate you, they come up to you and they shake your hand, or they touch your shoulder, or they shake your hand and hold your shoulder at the same time. So you don't need to give them a test, you just have to be observant. Thank you very much for that, Dr. Vicky.
Thank you.
Anyone else would like to, or Dr. Pena says, I enjoyed 1 Minute Manager. It's a very old book. It's from the 1990s, I think. But everything in there that's shared is still very, very relevant, because it comes not from a psychological survey or a research. It comes from a very experienced manager. So whether it's scientifically accurate or not, we never know. But what he teaches in there, I've been practicing and I found that it works for me. So I would recommend you try that out. All right. So before we begin, anybody else want to add on anything to this question? How do you motivate people? Please tell me in the text chat. If you have no questions, if you have no comments, this is how we interact. Give me an N in the text chat. N for Nazreen. So N means I can proceed. Otherwise, and some of you have done virtual classes before, if you do this, okay, what questions do you have? And I look at your screen, you look at my screen, nothing happens, we waste time, right? So every time I ask, what questions do you have? You either give me the question, if you have no questions, give me an N in the text chat, so I know to proceed. So let's try that out. If you have no questions, give me an N in the text chat, so I shall proceed. And we have 10 people in the room, let's see if we get 10 N's. Hello, Dr. Maslinda, just popped in. Welcome, welcome. All right, that's 4 N's, 5 N's so far. There should be another 5 coming. 6. Seven. Got 7 ends. How many people do we have or more? Because MS Teams tells me 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, plus 6. We should be 11. Anybody else? All right. Thank you for your time. Let's continue. The topic today, now that we've primed you into a mindset of talking about motivating people, I'm going to have to tell you that motivating people is basically not your goal. It's not something that you can do. People can only motivate themselves. And this is highlighted in, it started as an experiment, but that experiment has involved a lot of other research later on in the future. But in 1945, Dr. Karl Duncker posited the candle problem. And what he did was, he got people into a room and he said to them, here is the problem. I want you to create a situation where you can put the candle in this box, okay? And you can have the candle drip into the box itself. Okay, you have candle drip into the box itself. So what happened was, he tested it on people and he found that they could or could not solve the problem based on certain factors. So what he did was, he said, we're going to pay you $20. That's a lot of money back there. We're going to pay you $20 if you can actually solve this problem. So people got to solving the problem, okay? And it turns out, people couldn't get it done. The answer is something like this, which means that it requires you to actually think out of the box. So when he tested on people who, he said to them that we will give you money, it created pressure. It created pressure to perform. And what happens was, the pressure to perform actually dulled their creativity. And this was a bit of an interesting finding. If you get them to do routine work, things that they do normally every single day, and you give them money as a reward, what happens is they will work harder, they will work faster, they will work stronger. But when you give them a creative piece of work, when you give them work that requires them to actually think through a problem, money actually compounds the problem. It makes it even more difficult. It makes it even harder too, because your brain is now split into solving the problem and getting the bonus. Whereas if you do more routine work, what happens is it becomes a lot easier. And then I know the concept is a bit outdated, but if we use the analogy of left brain, right brain, what they said was that when you do more routine work, you're using more of your left brain. And that is something you can motivate people by giving money. But when you give them creative work, when they have to figure out something, they are accessing more of their right brain. And the money, right, the reward is still more of a left brain target. So now your processing is split between trying to get the money and then trying to solve the problem at the same time. And this is where the you can short yourself out, you can confuse yourself, because you are not focused on one thing. You're not focused on two things. So when the left brain tasks are rewarded, they discovered the performance rises. You can actually get people to do better when you give them a reward. But when the right brain tasks are rewarded, performance actually drops. So think about this, right? This is something that happens every day in our life, whether it be with our families or with our children, our students, our colleagues, our staff. Why is it that you decide to give only verbal appreciation? Because if you give money for the tasks that your people do that are more creative, you'll find that it's a lot difficult to get them to be creative. But if their work is routine, every single day is the same thing again and again and again and again, it's something part of their job description, then you'll find that their performance can rise. Now, this is challenging for a lot of HR. And I've spoken to a lot of HR. They say they know of this, but the system has been too entrenched. Yeah, the system has been too entrenched for many, many years that it's difficult to change in the corporate world. Corporate world still thinks that you throw money at people and they will do better. Of course, there are some companies who understand that this is not the way, and they've been making some changes. I'll show you some of these companies later. But generally, it's still the same. Throw money at people and they will do better. And when they don't do better, we fire them, we find someone else. So if you really want to help people grow, you actually want people to learn and develop themselves and be better employees, then you want to reconsider. I'm not saying don't do it. I'm saying you might want to reconsider giving them targets of money to hit. The higher the rewards for right brain activities, they discovered, the worse the performance is. Again, because the target is either, is it solving the problem or is it getting the money? White collar workers, meaning people who are K workers, like knowledge workers, are doing less left brain work and more right brain work. And now with artificial intelligence coming up, they will take away a lot of the routine jobs that we're doing. So we need to prepare our children, our students, for more right brain capacity, because otherwise they will not be able to keep up. Last but not least, what does it mean? It means that extrinsic or outer motivators no longer work. We need to develop more intrinsic motivation. So now, I've been going very slow because I suspect you understand this, but I want to make sure that you do. We might have a mixed crowd. What questions or comments do you have? Please tell me in the text chat. If you have no comments or questions, you know what to do. Give me an N so I know to continue. Okay, again, if you have questions, please ask now. If you have no questions, give me an N. So far, okay, two people so far. All right, three. Thank you very much. So I want to introduce you to a concept. My question right now, how many people have seen and read this book called Drive? Give me a yes or give me a no. How many people have seen or read this book called Drive? Give me a yes or give me a no. Because if you say yes, you have read it, then you will be co-facilitating with me today. Ubu says no. Anyone else? Give me a yes or no. It's only two options. All right. So today's topic is based on Drive Plus. Yeah, Drive Plus, which means that if I were to give you just Drive, then you might as well just read the book. Why would you come today? No, I'm going to add on one more. So Daniel H. Pink wrote this book called Drive. It's going crazy. People are loving it in the corporate world because it simplifies a lot of research into intrinsic, not extrinsic, but intrinsic motivation. How to motivate people by understanding what motivates them. Yeah, how to motivate people by understanding what motivates them. So he comes up with a model, and the model is MAP. And I added on one, which is S, and I'll explain a little bit why later. He says the first thing that people look for, especially millennials and more, if you go backwards into, say, the baby boomer generation or the Gen X, this might not be true. But coming from Gen Y forwards, okay, extrinsic motivators no longer work. Because why? They've gamed the system. The millennials have understood. And they are no more authentic. Interesting. Millennials, Gen Ys, are far more authentic to themselves. They are far more true to themselves than we were with ourselves. And this is why everybody says, why are these people being so rude? Oh, these students now, these young people are very rude. When I was younger, we were not like this. You know, we were deferent to the older generation, things like that. And I say to them, well, do you know what happened? You created this generation. For good or for worse, you created this generation. Because this generation grew up listening to you and your parents complain about your work. Right? Parents would come home, they would look tired, they would have no time for their kids, and they would complain about not having a lousy boss. They would complain about the work is horrible, it takes up too much time, they have to go they get stuck in traffic jams and stuff like that. And then that older generation gives the advice to the younger generation, you know, when you start working, don't let anybody walk over you. Don't let anybody tell you what to do. Don't allow people to belittle you. If you don't like, there's always many work, all many jobs out there. If you don't like this job, go and find another job. So guess what? We created that generation that we don't like. Because these people are far more mobile. They're far more agile. They're willing to change because they think they're worth more. And we told them that. We told them that you are a human being. Nobody can treat you the way that these people are treating you. Don't let yourself be stepped on. All right? So what does it mean? It means that the younger generation are listening to what we told them. They are responding to everything the older generation complained about. So they go, well, you're not treating me well in this job. I'm not getting what I came for. I'm going, bye-bye. And they find another job. Which means that the younger generation are far more empowered. As much as we don't like to say it, yeah, they're far more empowered. They are willing to speak up. They are willing to defend themselves. They're willing to ask for their rights. Of course, there are a few bad apples out there, but this is what has happened. And I would say, I think we should feel proud. We should feel proud that we've created a generation that is willing to question authority. Sadly, if we are now that authority, then we have to be able to provide answers. Because if we are the ones still underneath the old hierarchical mentality, these people are not. And when they take over, you will find that there's a new way of working. In fact, there's a lot of new companies now that are practicing a lot of this new mentality. And I joined one of these for about 7 years. I was amazed that they became very deliverable oriented rather than clock in, clock out oriented. The first few days I joined the company, my boss came up to me and said, what are you doing? And I said, nothing. So I'm telling you right now, it was 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So my boss says, what are you doing? And back then I was young, I was very efficient, I was very effective. I jumped into work and very workaholic. So I got my task for the day and I finished it. I had nothing else to do for the day. So again, this is what happened. My boss asked me, what are you doing? And I said, I'm doing nothing. He says, have you finished everything? And I said, yes. Do you want some more? I said, no. And then my boss, she said, go home. I'm like, what? Go home. Don't waste electricity, don't waste the internet. Go home. You finish your task already, go home. And I was shocked. I was like, what kind of silly way of working is this? Oh, no, it's a deliverable, performance-based workspace. That means if you are given a task per day and you manage to finish it, that's it, go home. Everybody loves to hear this. When I tell the story, everybody loves to hear this. But they forget to ask for the flip side. And the flip side is, if you have not finished your tasks, then you cannot go home. You have to finish everything, then you can leave. So there's a pro and a con to both to that kind of way of working. But there's so many alternative ways of working now. In fact, COVID-19 has fast-tracked work from home. When I was at that company for 7 years, there were days when I'm malas to come in. I just call my boss, say, I don't feel like coming in today. Can I work from home? And boss says, go ahead, okay, can. So I would work from home. But then it got boring and I would go back to work anyway. So there are things out there that are happening that not all of us are realizing. For example, they call this the new norm, right? Meeting online, training online, they call it the new norm. But for 7 years, that's all we did because our company was 500,000 staff globally. I had to train people from other countries, other continents. For me, it was normal. But I'm happy to see that the new norm is now catching up. Now you know what it felt like back then for us. Now you know what it feels like to have 3 a.m. conference calls with Chicago because it's 3 p.m. in Chicago, it's 3 a.m. in Malaysia. So that being said, I hope you are prepared to accept the fact that change happens. And if you fight the change, you will lose. You are a single individual person. You cannot fight the change. And I'll give you a simple example. There was one CEO. Okay, this CEO calls me and says, Nazrin, my staff is all millennial. Train them how to be able to do the work better. And I said to this boss, I said, frankly, right, when I look at them, I've done their survey. They're doing their work according to how they believe it should be done. And the performance is high, right? They're doing the work properly. And he says, no, not like that. So I said, you have a choice. I can train all of your staff and you pay me a lot of money, or I'll just train you to know how to interact and manage them. I didn't get the job though, because I was being honest. He didn't like my answer because he thought the people who needed to be changed are the people down there, not the people up there. Now, I believe you understand what I'm saying because I'm sure you feel the same. Why send us for training? We're not the problem. So I think you're laughing on the other end. This happens in all organizations. Leadership thinks that the problem stems from below, when the fact is leadership should be leading. Leading by example, they should be setting the culture. So how do we set the culture? How do we create that kind of environment? According to Daniel Pink, there are several things that young people and even younger people will respond to. Number one is the M, the desire to become better at something. Mastery says that when you give people challenges, small challenges, not challenges that will, you know, have them fail, small challenges for them to practice, and then you tell them that I believe you can do this, right? So if they do something routine every single day, what happens is their brain looks for challenges. And this is why they will go home at night at 5 o'clock and they will play guitar, they will play PlayStation 5, they will do things because that's the only way they can become good at something. Children, for example, if they're not good at sports because they cannot become better at sports, they go home and they play video games, they play Among Us, they play League of Legends, they play, God, what is it, Mobile Legends, whatever they play nowadays, okay? They play things and they actually become better at it. So when you look at your children playing games, they're actually developing a lot of their cognitive side of the brain. They're actually problem solving. And I sat watching my kids play. Yesterday, they were playing Mobile Legends together on their tablets and on their phones. And I'm like, okay, let me watch and see what happens. And I was amazed. Their reaction time, their ability to problem solve, their ability to work together. Maso, come together. I'm like, okay, cool. Now, how do I translate this into having them do better at their studies or better, you know, having them go out and have friends? So when somebody is strong at something, you don't kill that. You take that and you pass it along to something else. So mastery is everyone has a desire to become better at something. So now I'm going to ask you, ladies and gentlemen in the room, including Dr. Amira, including Umu, what is it do you want to become better at something? And try and give me a skill. Don't give me a philosophy like, I want to become a better human being. No, like that. I'm going to give you 3 minutes. I want everybody in the room to tell me. Tell us, everyone in the room, what do you want to become better at in your life? Okay? Umo says cooking for others. I want to become better at cooking for others. Good. How about everyone else? As for me, I would like to become better at marketing. I do a lot of training, but I don't market very well. I would love to learn how to be do marketing better. Training is for me routine already. It doesn't excite me as much. But marketing does. And I'm looking into digital marketing right now. Thank you, Umo. Anyone else? There's either a lag time between me and you, or you're thinking very hard. Dr. Hairul. Okay, Vicky says, better in my public speaking skills. Dr. Hairul says, Alhamdulillah, okay, that means I also have to do this better, Dr. Hairul. I want to do better at waking up in the middle of the night for tahajjud. Dr. Lisa, communication. Can you please share with me a bit more? No, I'm not going to ask you to turn on the microphone, don't worry. But what do you mean, communication in what specifically? Dr. Masnada says, better mom for my kids. Good. That's a bit philosophical, Dr. Masnada. Can you share with me specifically what do you mean by better mom? Is it giving them more time? Is it giving them more motivation? At what? What is that specific thing you want to be better at? More spiritual training? What do you want to focus on? Everyone else, please. Yes, give them more time. So you want to spend more time with them, more quality time. Okay, any more? We have a lot of people in the room. So tell me, what do you want to become better at? Thank you, Dr. Lisa. Better at communicating with different layers of people at work and outside. Good. Dr. Hazlina says, I want to be better at time management. Some more. We've got only five answers only. We got six answers. Okay, I'll assume everyone else is multitasking. Now, the people who answered, I need you to prepare to type into the keyboard. Thank you, Dr. Shamia. Better in public speaking. I'm going to ask you this question, right? And I want you to be prepared to answer with yes or no. If I, Nazrin, am able to give you the opportunity or the learning or actually give you a situation where you can be better at this, right? I am able to help you do this. My question is, will I have more influence over you? Give me a yes or no. If I'm able to help you be better at time management, public speaking, give more time to your children, if I can teach you how to do this, or I can give you an opportunity, okay, Dr. Azlina, today you finish at 3 o'clock, you go home and spend time with your kids. If I can do that, will I have more influence over you? Okay, Vicky says yes. Dr. Azlina says yes. Anyone else? It's either yes or no. Yes. So, guys, this is how you get influence over people, because human beings, like it or not, we are economical creatures. For everything that we do, we expect something back. And please, we set aside cerita pasal ikhlas. Even ikhlas means that we want to get to heaven. We were created to be able to give and get. So when you get married, I have never seen anybody say, darling, I marry you because I want to do everything for you. You don't need to do anything for me at all. No. When you're friends with someone, you gain benefit from someone. So the more benefit you get from someone, the more influence they have over you. As a boss, as a teacher, as a mother, as a father, as a son, as a daughter, when you can allow people to become better at what they are, you will have more influence over them. And this is why lecturers, teachers, trainers, leaders create influence. Because the people under them, please lah, look at it this way. More people come back to you, if you're a lecturer, more students come back to you 10, 20 years down the line to say thank you very much for what you did, versus coming back to their bosses. Which means why? Bosses don't create influence, they destroy influence more. So people who teach, people who lecture, people who do training, and you help improve people's lives, they appreciate you more. So now, how about the intrinsic motivation? How do we do this? Okay, we'll talk about that a little bit later after the break. The second one is autonomy. How do you get people to listen to you and follow you? By giving them independent choices. You give them a freedom to choose. Now, again, autonomy is not 100% autonomy. In some cases, yes. For example, I am sure you have some staff, you have some colleagues who they cannot work with other people, or they cannot work under supervision. They say, boss, I know how to do this. Trust me, let me do it. So if you have someone like this, you still need to supervise, but your supervision is based on, okay, I will let you do the work, all I need from you, because I need this data. Right? Every half day, give me an update on what you're doing. That's all. Okay, just give me an update on what you're doing. So some people are like this. So autonomy is the desire to make independent choices. I'll give you a simple example about autonomy, right? If you look at, but then this thing doesn't exist anymore. If you look at Carrefour dah tak ada dah. Let me give you another example. Giant lah, but Giant also on the way out. If you go to Giant, okay, I got a new example. Sorry about that. Tesco, if you ever go to Tesco, right? And you go to the counter to pay, and I'm sure you've seen this happen before. Somebody decides, tak nak lah barang ni, tapi dah scan. the cashier has already scanned it, and then suddenly the customer says, I don't want that one. So tell me the tech chat, what happens next? Yeah, Tesco sudah dijual. Doctor dah dijual to a Thailand company. Tapi Tesco in Malaysia and Southeast Asia saja. Tesco in UK still belongs to UK. So my question, what happens next? After you say, I don't want this, but already scared. Okay, next thing happens is the cashier will make a face. And then what? Tell me in the text chat, what do you know will happen next? What will the cashier do? While we're waiting for answers, yes, Giant has been sold to a Hong Kong company, last I heard. And then Tesco in Malaysia, bukan Tesco global, Tesco in Malaysia has been picked up by a Thai company. So if they decide to rebrand, buang lah, tapi Tesco punya brand quite strong. Okay, nobody's answering me, so I'll tell you. The cashier at Tesco will press a button, and then a light will go on, and their supervisor will come. What will their supervisor do? The supervisor will bring a key, yeah, or they will key in a code into the cashier and it will refund. Now imagine this, how much time did it take for that supervisor to walk over or even notice the light in the first place? That's all the supervisor does, pusing, key in code atau pusing kunci. Because why? They don't trust the cashiers. There's a reason for that. The cashiers, if you notice, they are very young, and they are day workers, and in many cases they are foreigners. So imagine if you give them the code for the cashier, you give them the key to the cashier, so they don't have autonomy there. But who does have autonomy? If you go to Aeon, all of the cashiers, whenever you say, I don't want this, what do? They don't need to call a supervisor. All they have to do is they can key in the code and they remove the item. And you can see the difference between the Tesco cashiers and the Aeon cashiers. The Aeon cashiers, their body language, their work, they seem to have more pride in their work because they have more control. Whenever you have more control over something, yeah, then you have a more sense of self. You have more pride. And anybody who can give that, if you give autonomy to your children, your children naturally want autonomy. In what sense? Tapa, adik boleh buat. Tapa, adik buat sendiri. They want to do it themselves because it is part and parcel of every human being. People love to know that they can do something alone. So, intrinsically, from the inside, how are they motivated? They're motivated by mastery. They're motivated by autonomy. The next one is purpose. Okay, so purpose is different from mastery and autonomy in that it is the desire to have a noble cause. And this is one of the reasons why when we complain about the young generation don't want to work, they're choosy of their work. Kita dulu, I tak pilih kerja pun. I kerja je mana-mana. Well, again, we did that to them as well. We said to them, as an older generation, if you're going to go to do work, find a company that does good work. Okay, something you can be proud of. Something that will be, you can tell your children, oh yeah, I work for this company, you know. So, of course, they don't want to work for Kianju Canning Factory. Of course, they don't want to work for small companies. Because these companies, the cause, they don't see it happening. They want to be able to work for a company that does something good. And I'm not saying this is for everyone, but deep down inside, if you were to work for a company that does something evil, you know for sure it's evil, right? Would you work for it? Some people say, if I have no money and that's the only job, okay lah. But the younger generation, they're willing to starve as long as they get to work at a company that has a noble cause. And this is interesting for me to share with you. The company in Malaysia that is finding it very, very difficult to find staff now is BAT, British American Tobacco. They just keep offering more and more money. Nobody wants to work for them. Yeah, it's becoming a HR nightmare simply because they cannot find people who wants to work for them because nobody believes in their company, nobody believes in their products, nobody believes in their cause. Unless people are very, very desperate. And I know because some of them are my friends, they have worked there, tapi sekejap saja. Even they compromise their principles sekejap saja, lepas tu they leave. BAT is one company that's finding it very, very difficult. And this is not a secret knowledge, actually it's an open secret lah. Everybody in the industry knows it. So more and more people look for not just the money, but they want to be proud that they're working someplace. Yeah. So the idea is this. If you want your people to stay with you, you want people to be able to do the work, provide them a noble cause. What is University Malaya's noble cause? What is your department's noble cause? Why are they doing this work? And this is not a new concept. This is a very old concept. It is a concept so old that there are some stories, apocryphal stories or stories that we cannot prove. One is JFK, right? The former president passed, who was assassinated, former president of the United States. After he launched the space race to be able to get America to the moon, one day, this is a story, the story is not proven. One day, he walks into NASA, and as he's walking down the corridor of NASA, he sees a janitor mopping the floor. And he asks the janitor, what are you doing? And he says, I am helping to put a man on the moon. And that story has been repeated so many times. Of course, that story, we don't know whether it's true or not, but there is one story directly reported from Dr. Donald Kirkpatrick. Dr. Don Kirkpatrick was in a conference in Brunei He went to Brunei and he stayed at a hotel. And he loves to do this. He loves to walk up to people and ask people about these things. Now, the story is a bit embarrassing, eh? Because he does it twice. Once in Brunei, once in Malaysia. So when he was at Brunei, at the hotel, he saw this window washer washing the windows outside of the hotel, these big, big windows. And he just casually asked, "Excuse me, sir, what are you doing?" And then the window washer turns to him and says, "I'm helping create a good guest experience for all our hotel guests." What's he doing? He's washing the windows. But what does he answer? He says he's creating a good guest experience for all the hotel guests. Now, the embarrassing part is he comes to Malaysia a few weeks later for another conference and he does it again. And he sees someone else doing something similar. And he asks, "What are you doing?" And the window washer says, "I'm washing windows." So who is more motivated between one and the other is someone who knows why they're doing it. I'll give you one more story. And this one is the origin of all this, right? A man came across three different people, all of them working on building a wall. So one person was laying bricks, putting the bricks and the cement. Another person was also laying bricks, putting bricks and cement. Third person was also laying bricks, putting bricks and cement. He asked the first person, "What are you doing?" And he says, "I'm laying bricks." He asked the second person, "What are you doing?" And he says, "I'm building a wall." He asked the third person, "What are you doing?" He says, "I'm building a palace." The difference between the three people indicate how much do they see of why they're doing something. If your staff does not know why they're doing something, all they see is, "I'm doing a report." You buat apa? I think about report. Okay? Then if that's all they see, they will not be able to contribute to the bigger picture. Now, here's the problem. Only leaders have the big picture. They very rarely share it with their people. And when they share it in the most boring way possible. It's written down in a souvenir book somewhere. It's given in a speech that nobody listens to. It's not reiterated every single day. So if you say that we are here in the business of creating smarter people every single day, that University Melaya is in the business of helping people become smarter and more able to compete in the workplace and create a better economy for Malaysia, then what you're doing is, even though it's a small part, but you're contributing to that. So people love to be driven by purpose. Now, this is Daniel Pink. When I was at this company called Accenture, it was a consulting company, I learned that this is not enough. There is one more. And I believe some of you will agree to this. The last driver is called stewardship. And stewardship is not a desire to become just good at something or to be independent of a boss or to have an internal drive to achieve something. It's actually to leave something behind. Why am I doing this? I know I'm going to die, so I want to build a system in this department. Before I leave this department, I want this department to run better than before I left it. Okay? I know I'm going to leave soon. I know I'm going to push somewhere else. Maybe I'll leave the university, but before then, I'll make sure that this system is up and running. I'll make sure the people are enabled so that by the time I leave, I will have left something behind that can run on its own and it's good. That is stewardship. Now, here's the thing. Depending on personality type or depending on traits, depending on how people are wired, everybody has a preferred one. So I'm going to ask everyone in the room, 8 + 5 people, which of these drivers drive you the most? Which of these drivers drive you the most? So please tell me in the text chat, is it mastery? Is it autonomy? Is it purpose? Or is it stewardship? I'll mute my microphone for 2 minutes. Please tell me your answers. Everyone, please tell me your answers. Here we go. If you don't understand, please ask me. I spent about 15 minutes explaining these four and hope you got a good definition. So my question is, which of these drive you the most? All right, here we go. We're getting some answers here. Vicky says mastery. Fazlin says purpose. Azlina says stewardship. Okay. Thank you. We have 3 so far. Keep going. Keep going. I would love to hear from everybody. We've had 3 answers so far. Okay, Lisa says, until 10 years back, mastery, now purpose. Cool. All right. Can I say all are important? Of course, all are important. But if push comes to shove, which one do you respond to the most, Dr. Hairul? Which one do you respond to the most? Stewardship, okay. Thank you. All right, you knew this was coming, so I'm going to ask you now. Vicky, I've spoken to already. Dr. Hara, I've spoken to already. Let's ask Ferlinda Fazlin. I would love to ask you, please turn on your microphone, and then please tell me more about what is your purpose and what drives you. I don't hear you yet. Can you please turn on your microphone and share with us? You don't have a mic.
Okay. Mr. Nazri, hold on.
Double. Who said hold on? Sorry, who said hold on? Was it?
No, I because she's just beside me.
Oh, okay, okay. All right. So share with me then.
Hold on. Finally.
I'm so sorry. I don't have a mic. I'm sorry.
That's okay. Now you do.
Okay. I think the purpose is. You mean my purpose?
Your purpose. So when you say you're driven by purpose, mm-hmm. if I was your boss, if I was your supervisor, what would I say to get you to be able to do something that touches on your purpose? So for example, everyone shared their what they want to become good at in mastery. And I said, well, if I were to give Dr. Samia the ability to be good, better at public speaking, then my influence over her will grow because she'll go, wow, I can actually become better at public speaking under this boss. So if I wanted to drive you with your purpose, I need to know what your purpose is. So what's your purpose for working in UM, for example?
I think basically my purpose is to get things done in the most appropriate way.
Okay. So when we say purpose, we say noble cause. The noble cause, why are you doing it for the in the most appropriate way?
Because my life motto is... I don't want to. Saya tak nak menyusahkan orang lain.
There you go.
So when you get the work thing the work right in the right process, so kita kurangkan masalah, and then you know when everything is done properly, then there will be no problem, and that purpose is everyone macam senang.
There you go. So if your supervisor doesn't know this about you, then it's going to be difficult for him or her to motivate you. But if I know that, okay, her purpose is dia tak suka menyusahkan orang, then I can give you opportunities to practice that. Say, okay, we need this by 5 o'clock, all right? And I know you'll be able to do a good job because when we finish all of this, all of us can go home.
Yeah.
And then you suddenly feel the pressure, alamak, if I, kalau aku tak buat ni kan, mesti mau tak boleh balik-balik rumah. Okay, tak apa-apa, I will do, let me do. Does that make sense? Do you understand what I just said?
Yes, I understand.
Okay, now, this can border on manipulation a little bit, but what it really means is when you understand your people, then you know how to motivate them to get work done. Thank you very much for that. Okay, so Dr. Hazlina, I hope you have a microphone.
Yes, I do.
All right, so stewardship, I would expect that, but of course it's stereotyping like that, but I would expect that of academicians and lecturers. But I don't know what you do. So can you please tell me, what do you mean by stewardship?
I would, my stewardship here is, I would want to do something that would definitely beneficial to my students. At the end of the day, what I have given is just a bit, but what they will do outside there when they're working, it will give the impact to them. So that is the purpose of what I said, stewardship. Besides that, working as a lecturer, I think at the end of the day, is to give something to back to community. So I think that legacy would be something that I would want to give back to community. Like, for example, like helping people, yeah, educate them. But it's a community area, so it's targeted. But I think that would be something, hopefully, at the end of the day, is like lillahi ta'ala lah, yeah, a reward for jannah lah. I think that is the goal. That is my purpose.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Can I do a bit of a test on you?
Sure, sure.
If I were to ask you to do something small, but you don't see an impact in the long term, right? Would you do it?
Yeah, sure. Why not?
Sure. But if I were to give you something to do small, and I say, this will benefit the students in the next few years, how would you feel between these two tasks? What would be the feeling?
If you were to do small, that still benefit the students, why not?
Okay, but the first one, I don't tell you that there's a benefit. I just say go and do this. But the second one, I tell you that when you do this, you will impact the student body for years to come. What will be the difference in that feeling?
That would be a long term. Hmm? The first one would be a short term. You never know what outcome would be. Even though it's a simple, but there's no goal.
Yep. So my question is, how would you feel?
I'll take it both.
You're giving me analysis, but you haven't been answering the question. How do you feel? What would be the feeling?
The feeling?
The difference between the first and the second one.
The feeling, of course, the first one may be uncertain because you don't know what is the goal. The second one, you know what is the goal, so the achievement or the target might be clearer what you're doing.
Cool. So can you give me the answer? How would you feel? Right now you're giving me a logical analysis. Tell me the feeling you feel.
For both?
For the second one.
For the second one, I would feel rather committed.
More committed than the first one?
The first one, of course not happy, but just to fulfill it only.
Boleh lah, buat kerja, buat lah kan, boss
buat,
buat kan.
Buat je lah.
Buat je lah. So, this is what happens when someone who is very stewardship oriented, right? You tell them to do something, they can do it, but you might see some lack in quality. You might see some lack in time management. Mungkin like dia buat betul tinggal. But if someone is stewardship oriented and you can see that in them, they could be students, they could be staff, they could be friends. When you give them something and you inform them or you frame it in such a way that it has a long-term impact on people and they are stewardship oriented, you have matched the goal to them, watch them go at it. They will go all out. Tak cukup dia akan tambah. Tak cukup dia tambah duit sendiri kadang-kadang. Would you agree to that, Doctor?
Yes.
Would you agree to saying that there are people out there like this?
Yes.
Yes. Thank you very much. So here's the thing, right? Not all people respond to all four MAPNS. There will be some people respond a bit more. Dr. Hairul Slumber, he has revealed himself. So if you're supervising him, semua empat-empat boleh pakai. But if it comes down to one, he will say stewardship more than others. So you need to start thinking about your people, your family, your children, because some of them, malahlah mama, tak naklah buat, because probably they're not mastery oriented. But if you say, tolong mama buat siapkan benda ni, tolong mama, dia akan tolong. That's why you have some children yang berbeza-beza kan. Some of them, you give them a task, okay, siapa nak siapkan benda ni? Okay, terus dia buat. Sebab kenapa? bagi vacuum ke, bagi 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 penyapu ke apa, they love to become better at sweeping. They love to become better at vacuuming, so they master it. Kadang-kadang you have to read it very carefully. With my children, some of them, you kata, I say, come let me help you vacuum. Eh, tak payah, tak payah, tak payah. Dia, dia nak vacuum sendiri. So in that case, itu bukan mastery. You notice dia vacuum-vacuum tak makin, tak makin pandai pun. But they are enjoying the independence. So, again, each and every one that you know will have a different love language. I mentioned that it. Similarly, they will have a different driver. Okay, so by the mastery, autonomy, purpose or stewardship. Now, I want you to think about this. We're going to take a break in about 5 minutes. But before we take our break, I want you to think about the people around you, whether it be your staff, whether it be your students, whether it be your children. Okay, I want you to identify one person. One person, do the analysis with as little information I've given you. Do the analysis. Tell me, I have one. You don't have to tell me child or student. You don't have to tell me who that person is. But I want you to write down, what do you think their driver is? So for example, I'm giving you an example here. I want you to type in something like this, mastery. And then how do you know that they are mastery oriented? For example, I know someone is mastery oriented because every time I give them the task, they will try again and again. Even though the task is siap, they will practice again and again until they get it right. Dia tak puas hati. Dia tak puas hati the first time dia buat tak betul. So they want to get it perfect. So I'll give you about 4 minutes to think about this. And when you've identified that person, don't have to tell me who that person is. All I want is you identify, okay, orang ini, I nampak dia lebih kepada stewardship. Kenapa? Sebab kalau I suruh dia buat benda, dia tak suka, dia tak buat benda. Tapi kalau I kata, you buat benda ni, orang lain akan dapat benefit, tiba-tiba seronok pula dia nak buat. Okay, so you have about 3 minutes now. Think about it and please give me your answers. There are no right nor wrong answers. I would like to see your analysis, not analysis, the output of your analysis. Tell me what driver do you think they are and why. How do you know? Give me the observation. Okay, 3 minutes, here we go. All right, you have 2 minutes to go. Please start putting in your answers. Can be anybody, can be family member or staff or even a colleague. Or even a boss, if you want. All right, let's see what answers pop up. All right, 1 more minute to go. Thank you, Vicky. Every time I give this person, or mastery, every time I give this person a task, he does it above my expectation and always keeps on trying new things, which impresses me. I feel there's a need for me to learn a few things from him. He has been a name that I keep mentioning at home and telling my daughter that she needs to be like him. Well done. So, in order to motivate this person, now you know the switch. You know the switch for this person, and you know that this is, okay, if I need something for him to get done, I give him something challenging, I give him something that he will rise to. Because if you give the wrong task to the wrong person in the team, then the problem is they might not rise to the occasion. Now, guys, we're not talking about developing people, yeah? We're talking about driving people. Developing people, we use a different model. And that's not something we're talking about today. For example, you want to have someone who's autonomy-oriented face challenges. That means you're doing something different. You're actually giving them something that will challenge them, and that makes them uncomfortable. Here, what we're talking about is we're giving them what they're comfortable with. Mastery-oriented people are comfortable with challenges. Yeah, but drive does not talk about developing people. It talks about giving them what they want, so you get what you want as a leader. Okay, Fazlin says, stewardship, every time a task is given, they will ask if it is necessary and beneficial to the community. Actually, it can sound like purpose, but it sounds more like stewardship in this. It sounds more like stewardship. Because purpose will be for themselves, right? For example, you say, I tak nak menyusahkan orang. Okay, so that has nothing to do with other people. It's more about you don't like to menyusahkan orang. So this statement, okay, your analysis sounds more like stewardship than it does purpose. Thank you. Let's look at everyone else. Let's look at other answers. Wow, you guys really putting it into it. Tak apa, saya bagi masa sikit. For those people who are not going to be typing in, I need to know, because otherwise we'll be just spending time. If you're not going to be typing in, please give me an N in the text chat so we know not to wait for you. If you're not going to provide an answer, please give us an N in the text chat. Okay, thank you. Any more? All right, thank you very much everyone for your answers. I hope this has given you a good introduction to the concept of MAPNS to drive people. We're going to take a 15-minute break. We'll come back at 10:47 on my clock, and then we will continue deep diving into each and every one of them until time is up, until noon. So thank you very much everyone. We'll see you in 15 minutes. Have a good break. Bye-bye. Hello everybody. We are going to start in about 1 minute's time. So let me just get a sense how many people are back and ready to go. Please type in ready in the text chat. How many people are back and ready to go? Please tell me ready in the text chat. Hello, Vicky. Thank you. All right, cool. So we have three people. I know Umu is there, so that's four people ready. Anyone else? Thank you, Dr. Athini. Welcome back. Okay, so let's kick it off. So for those who came in a bit late, my name is Nazrin, and I am your facilitator for today. We are talking about people drive. And what is that specifically? Well, we are seeing what factors can we engage, what factors can we influence in order to have people motivate themselves. Why? Because sure, there's such a thing as extrinsic motivation, which means that we motivate them from the outside, but there's also something called intrinsic motivation, where there is something that they motivate themselves from the inside. And what we've discussed, that extrinsic motivation works better when the performance is more routine, like say, you know, building a house or transporting things, driving from one place to another, which uses a lot of left brain, very logical, very structured sort of work. But when you expect people to do right brain work, when you want people to solve problems, when you want people to come up with solutions, when you want people to write books and stuff like that, extrinsic motivations don't work, they actually hinder. And that's why creative people find it more satisfying to be able to fulfill intrinsic motivations. And what we're talking about today is we're using a model from Daniel H. Pink, especially from his book called Drive. So if you want to know more about this, I recommend that you check out the book Drive by Daniel H. Pink. And I'm typing that into the text chat. Daniel Pink has written a lot of books on this, but Drive still remains one of the most popular, most famous ones in the corporate industries, in corporate management. So we've talked at a high level about each one: mastery, autonomy, and purpose. These three are the ones that Daniel Pink introduced. But in my time at a company called Accenture, we added on another one, and we call it stewardship, because we felt that something was missing. Some people argue that stewardship falls under purpose, but we see it very, very clearly that purpose is what drives you to do the work, right? A noble cause, a noble reason to do the work because of something that you're doing, right? You want to do something for a good cause. But stewardship is a bit more specific in that you want to leave something behind. You want to build a company that when you leave that company, you can see, okay, the more the company grows, the prouder you become. The more it impacts other people, the prouder you are. And I know that people in education, a lot of them, when I surveyed them, a lot more people in education answered stewardship versus purpose, versus autonomy, versus mastery. And that's why a lot of them don't mind if they work within a system, within the hierarchy, as long as they get to deliver and create students, they get to create long-term lasting effects. And I believe education was founded on that principle to create the future, a sustainable future. So let's deep dive into mastery. What are we talking about when we say mastery? So I've given the example that there are people out there who, when they do routine work, they get really, really bored. Yeah, and one example is a toll booth operator. Now we have less and less toll booth operators because it's become already quite routine, can be taken over by touch and go. Even in McDonald's, you no longer have people who do routine work at the counters anymore. You order on your own, you pay on your own. And it's a good start. Even before the pandemic started, McDonald's already implemented it. But people who do routine work at work and are mastery oriented, you will find that when they go home, right, they things, other things that satisfy them, satisfy their need for mastery. So with people like this, because mastery is a process of getting better and better at something, then they would love challenging work. And how you give challenging work is you tell them, I know you can do this, I've seen you do this before, okay, I'm going to give you something that will really test your abilities. Are you all right with this? And most of the time they'll go, okay, yes. But here's the thing about mastery, you cannot leave them like it's autonomy. You need to give them feedback. So for them, getting better depends on getting feedback. And this requires micro feedback on performance. Not 6 months once, not 1 year once. People who are mastery oriented, they will come up to you and say, hey, boss, is this okay? Is this, do you like it like this? So don't say, hey, shush, don't kacau lah, you go and do your work lah. They need that feedback. So please schedule a time. Okay, I'm busy right now. Tell you what, at 3 o'clock nanti, you come to me and we'll sit down, we'll look at this, okay? All right, go. So actually give them, okay, I come back at 3 o'clock, boss. Give them a time, give them space for them to get feedback. When you look at your children, okay, children, as they're growing up, they don't have a preference between mastery, autonomy, purpose, and stewardship. In many cases, they're still trying to figure it out. But if your child comes up to you and asks you, mommy, is this pretty or not, when they show you a drawing, please, even if you're doing work, do not ignore. Please, I'm asking you because I have 5 kids and I made that mistake before, and I have friends who are trainers in early childhood education. The damage that you can do there is severe. So even if you're on a meeting, right, even when you're in a virtual meeting, you can pause and to sneeze, right? You can turn off your camera to sneeze. You've done that before. Or you can say, excuse me a second, I need to go to the toilet, I'll be right back. You can do that, right? Even a surgeon who's performing surgery, if he needs to go to the toilet, he will stop and go. So I want you to treat your employees and your children when they are there getting feedback, either schedule it. With children, very difficult to schedule. With children, you say, that's pretty. Tell them some feedback at least, and then later on go back to them. Never ignore people, because people who are mastery oriented, sometimes we label them. We call them needy. We call them kurang kasih sayang. Of course, siapa yang kurang kasihkan dia? We say that they are attention seekers. They are not attention seekers. They want feedback. And feedback doesn't necessarily have to be recognition. They want feedback. So the feedback that you provide, okay, is at micro level and at macro level also considered. So if you think about children, when you multiply that into large organizations, they are adults, they are all people, and all people who are mastery oriented perform the same way. So for example, did you know that there are companies, this is my old company, there are companies who are getting rid of performance reviews. None of this 6 months, 1 year stuff anymore. So they are building in a culture where you give feedback every single day. And the feedback is specific. It's not just, oh, good job, that was really good. No, none of that. So I'm going to share with you, and I need you to write this down. Here are a few ways to give feedback that will get good responses. The first way, and I want you to write this down, the first way is called 2+1. Dua campur satu. Okay, 2+1. And 2+1, that says that when you want to get someone to become better, especially someone who's mastery oriented, you mention 2 things that you like about their work. Okay, two things that you like about their work. Plus one, you make a suggestion for improvement. I'll repeat that. Make a suggestion for improvement. So for example, if your staff comes up to you and gives you a report, you actually sit him down, and this person is mastery oriented, right? You sit him down and you say, okay, let me go through the report. All right. Okay, number one, I want to say, I love the way that you structure the report. It's easy for me to read. Okay, that's one. And then the second one, and please don't tell them I'm doing 2+1. Okay, I'm going to 2+1 you. Don't do that. Okay, just give them one compliment and then give another compliment. Okay, I also like how the paragraph, you don't start a new paragraph at the end of the page. I've seen people do this, right? The paragraph sudah sampai dekat hujung, and then at the last line, you open a new paragraph, which is just one line. I like that you press enter and it moves to the second page, so I can read it as a separate paragraph on its own. So that's two already. If you're writing this down, 2+1, that's already two. What about the plus one? Plus one is providing a suggestion for improvement. Now be very careful. It is not an area of improvement. Area of improvement means you need to improve your communication skills. Now, there's nothing they can do with that. They go, okay, communication skills. Apa dia? You need to improve your communication skills. It tells them nothing. Instead, give them a suggestion for improvement. For example, all right, now here's what, if you want to become better at this, the next time you send the report, before that, check that all the font is using our style guide. Okay, University of Malaya style guide, it says that you must use this font and this size. For the heading, this size. For the subheading, this size. And for the body text, this size. You get that done, this report will look much, much better. So what this is you provide a suggestion for improvement that is not related to them. Don't tell them you made a loud, you did not use the right font, you did not use the right sizing. Don't say that. Talk only about what they have to do. Now, both the two and the one, here's a recommendation. When you provide performance feedback, provide performance feedback on the action, on the behavior, not them. So in this case, you say, this report, this is a good report. Don't say you wrote a good report, because now it becomes personal. Because now when you say, when you comment on the report, dia akan terasa. So you say, this is a good report. Okay, this was written. Okay, this was, okay, I see. So now you say, when you comment on the performance, don't comment on the person. So there's two things, right? P plus A, person and action. You comment only on the action, not on the person. This allows you to make it more objective. Yeah, it allows you to make objective. With a child also, the recommendation is the same. When you give performance feedback, you don't say, wow, you're such a good artist. Because once you say that, when the next time she brings an ugly piece of art, can you still say that she's a good artist? You are now lying to her. Now you're giving her a false indication. And I know some people say, but she's a child, right? Tak payahlah nak apa ni jaga-jaga sampai macam ni. The thing is, yes, in fact, because she's a child, that's when you must take care of the most. That's when you must train him or her to be more critical thinking. And you start there. So when she or he brings their artwork and you say, wow, this is a beautiful piece of artwork. And you say, I'll tell you why it's beautiful. Because when you colored, it was within the lines. You see the coloring are inside the lines. There's no coloring outside the line. So that's one place. And then second, there were multiple colors used here. And then we go for the plus one. Now, if you take one more color and you add on to this, then it becomes even more colorful. What will happen? Those two compliments that you gave becomes anchored behavior. That two compliments you give becomes anchored behavior, and the chance of her repeating that behavior again is higher. I cannot say 100%, but the chance is higher because now they got validation, they got recognition for that behavior. And this is true for you as well. When your boss tells you you did something well, you want to receive some more compliments, you will keep doing the same thing again and again and again. But if your boss does not tell you which one you did well, which one you did not do well, so sometimes you will get scoldings because they only scold you because of what you don't do well. And this comes back to the original recommendation in the 1 minute manager. Catch people doing good or catch people doing the right things. If this is new for you and it becomes lecehnya like this, well, this is it. If you're leading people, nobody said being a leader was easy. This is what leaders have to do. They have to take care of people's emotions, at the same time, have them perform better. If you were just a manager, then you don't need to take care of people's emotions. All you take care of is the KPIs, which is something I've been discussing a lot with HR people and corporate people. A lot of trainers understand this, but a lot of corporate people don't understand this. KPIs only measure the targets, which means that you care only about the targets, only about the money. They don't care, they don't measure the satisfaction of the employees. And that tells you something, right? In my mind, I'm not saying this is 100%, I'm saying in my mind, a company that focuses only on KPIs sends the message that to their people that you are useful only if you make money for us. If you don't make money for us, we don't care about you. You are certainly replaceable. And that's something that interests me a lot, because one of my teachers said, you depend on your company, yeah, but when you fall sick, right, your company does not depend on you, they can find someone else to replace you. It's a harsh way of saying it, I understand, right? But it is something that you want to consider when you drive your people. That people are not only money driven, they're not extrinsic, they're also intrinsic. So back to the 2+1. How do you make 2+1 work? Always remember the 2 must be positive, but positive does not have to be flourishy. Oh, you're such a fantastic employee. Don't use superlative words. When you praise objectively, okay, and then give specifics. You must give specific detailed feedback, not good job, well done. Not just that. You can say that, but go deep dive the specifics. Why? Because they need to know which ones they did well. When they know which ones they did well, they will repeat the behavior. The plus one has to be something that is a suggestion for improvement, not an area for improvement. Area is too big, they tak faham, they will not know. You must improve your leadership skills. So they can't take action immediately. But if you give them suggestion, they can take action on the spot, you can monitor, and you can say, okay, that's it, keep going. Now, before we leave this one, okay, and you have a question, you can always ask, don't worry.
Yes, anytime. I have a question, Cik Nazrin.
Go ahead, Doctor.
This is Azlina.
Yes.
Yeah. How do you, I just want to state the problem here. Okay. How do you manage, let's say, if you have kids or students? I know that students, male student, always wake up late, especially during their morning class. Can we do or can we implement or apply 2+1? And I mean, what would be the strategy to manage this?
So the answer is this: 2+1 only works with people who are mastery oriented. I used to teach at UIA until my whole faculty physically moved to another state. Then I couldn't follow them. So I know what you're talking about. I have had male students, female students tak pernah ada masalah ni. But for some reason, male students, when I ask him why, dia main PS5, dia main PS malam-malam, so tak boleh bangun awal. I'm like, what the? So I understand what you're talking about. But if they are not mastery oriented, then 2+1 does not work very well. Yeah, if they're not mastery oriented, there's nothing. And I'm not saying that you can. There will always be someone you cannot capture. There will always be someone you have to let go, and you need to focus on the people who really do want to be there. So there is a you see, being a leader or being a teacher or a lecturer, there is a modicum of heartache. There's always someone you couldn't reach. There's always someone you couldn't save. And I think you know what I'm talking about. Okay, so the 2+1 will only work on mastery-oriented students. Do you have them?
Okay, so that means those students, male students that wake up late, they are not necessarily in mastery.
Not necessarily.
Segment. They could be like autonomy, purpose, and stewardship.
Correct.
But looking at that problem, how can we manage? Can we multiply or can we use a different application? But here, larger picture, we are talking about students. But what about your kids itself?
Okay, so with your kids, you need to properly identify what drives them first. So, for example, they move every single day. That's the weird part about kids, because kids, they belum lock into either MAPOS. Today they are mastery, tomorrow they are autonomy. So that's why it's tiring being a parent. You need to understand hari ni dia apa. So you ask different types of questions. You ask mastery type questions or autonomy type questions. For example, are you okay if I leave you to do this alone? And if that you see the face, concern face kan, okay, probably not autonomy. But if they say, ah, boleh, tak apa, mama, don't worry, dah adik buat. Okay, so then that day, they are autonomy oriented. With kids, not like adults. Adults, usually we have one preference and we stay with that preference for quite a while. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, so everything I'm sharing with you today is not the complete methodology for driving all human beings, but it is one that can help with a lot of them. You have to experiment. With my students, okay, I discovered I could do it with most of them, except for this one guy. And when I sent him for coaching with one of my friends, he's there because his parents sent him there. He didn't want to study in the first place. So he's intent on failing all of his courses just so he could get thrown out. So there are some people you cannot save. You can do your best, but the time is better spent on other people sometimes. Okay, so those are students. With staff, there will be a point in time where you have to send them to HR. There's nothing else you can do. Depending on your company's policy lah. Some companies are very family-oriented policy. Oh, no, we don't fire people. We just help develop them. But you cannot help everybody if they don't want to help themselves. Okay, sounds a bit philosophical, but from a time perspective, you have 24 hours a day to separate between different staff members. If there's one staff member that you've tried your best, you cannot save, then I won't use the word give up, I'll use the word let it go. Does that answer the question, Doctor? This is reality. We can have all sorts of fantastic books and models and theories, but in reality, you cannot
whether
save
it's
everyone.
Apply or not, right.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Because I have this experience talking about staff. They said, doctor, like for us, when we have problems, actually, we don't like this department, at least we can, what I would rather say that you all staff, you all, at least you can request to change department. But for lecturers, we can't do that. It's either the optional way is to quit the job or find other way.
Yes. And you, if I profile it right, good, most lecturers stay because of that feeling of stewardship. They stay, okay, I will suffer through this job because I think I can still make a difference in some people's lives. But it also has a lot of heartache lah, because students don't come, they don't listen to you.
You are forced to.
Yes. And you want to know what makes it even worse now, if you're doing virtual classes, you have students who don't turn on the webcam, who don't answer in the text chat, they're just there, and you have this feeling that, am I being listened to? Am I being respected? No, they're just to listen to you and sometimes doing other things as well. So I think you know what that feels like. Has anybody done virtual classes yet? Doctor, have you done any virtual classes yet?
Yeah, we are doing now.
Yeah, the feeling is magnified, right?
Exactly.
You're not sure whether you're making an impact, and then it makes you more and more depressed as the day goes along. So I hope that answers the question. And if anybody else has any questions on mastery, please ask me now. If you have no questions, give me an N in the text chat, so we will continue to the next one, autonomy. A lot of this seems to make sense at a high level, but what I want to share with you is some of the techniques that you can use. So let's recap. For mastery, the technique, the one simple technique is 2+1. This works on children, this works on adults. Because why? Because nobody gives people compliments. Yeah, the reason it works is because you are being different than other people, so they will listen to you. If everybody does 2+1, then maybe it gets watered down. dia macam inflation lah. But for now it works. Once upon a time, if you have learned this before, they used to call it the sandwich technique. So before 2 plus 1 is very new. It's only about 15 or 10 years old in the industry, this technique. Before this technique, we used to learn something called a sandwich technique. Give the good news first, then give the bad news, and then give another piece of good news. Okay, you did this report very well, but this part you didn't do very well. But don't worry, overall you did very well. So that was a sandwich technique. In the 70s and the 80s, they used to use it. It doesn't work anymore. Yeah, either because people have gotten smarter or people know the trick. 2 plus 1 still works very well. People don't see it. Don't teach it to them, so you'll know. Otherwise, they will know what's happening. But 2 plus 1 is more motivational because it identifies the correct behavior, anchors it, and then suggests a new growth behavior. So for example, if you're running 100 meters, okay, I say, fantastic, you've run 100 meters. Let's see if you can do 120 meters and you slowly get them there further and further and further. So what happens with 2 plus 1? When they do the job and the next time, that plus 1 now becomes part of the 2. Okay, so if that guy, I said, all you have to do is follow the style guide. The next round, he comes back with the report and I'll say, oh, okay. Well done, you followed the style guide. Okay, that's one compliment. I find another compliment to give and I find another suggestion for improvement. Okay, last thing before we leave mastery, I forgot to mention this, but it's critical. When you do 2 plus 1, please be very careful. That plus, though, there is a word you shouldn't use. And that word is but. So never do this. Oh, your report is really good, but. And then you plus one, but you should use a style guide. The human brain does not process negative words very, very easily. I'm not saying tak boleh langsung, but it doesn't process it very easily. It becomes very suspicious when it hears a negative word. So never use the word but. Don't use the word walaupun, walau bagaimanapun, sungguh pun begitu, tetapi, cuma. Avoid using these words between the two and the one. What can you replace it with? Well, you can replace it with nothing. Oh, this is the report is very good. It had this and it had this. One suggestion for improvement is this. Nothing in between. No but, no and, no nothing. Okay. The second suggestion is you can use the word and. All right. I like that the report was written like this. And if you use the style guide, this will be even more perfect. Okay. Nazrin likes to be a bit more dramatic because I do training. So when I give feedback in class, I like to use the word now. Well, this was a very good report. All of this and this and this is now. You use a style guide, this will be even more fantastic. It'll be even more perfect. So choose what you want. Just avoid the negative words. When can you use negative words in feedback? When the positive is actually flipped. Okay? So the negative is in front and the positive is at the back. So I have an example. For example, you might think you're not smart, but, and you flip it to the positive. I have seen you do the work. I have seen you write the articles. I know you can do this. That's when you can use the word but. Yeah, when you're giving feedback, be very careful of negative words. So what are those words? But, however, even however is very dangerous. Tetapi, cuma, walau bagaimanapun, cukup begitu. And my favorite, this one I mentioned, track, not only in Malaysia, Southeast Asia, in the Philippines pun ada, in Cambodia pun ada. Because I do work in Cambodia, so I know. This one, I don't know if you heard it, but it's that clicking sound Malaysians like to make with their mouth. Wah, report ni bagus eh. So be careful of that as well. All right, so that takes care of mastery. Let's take a look at autonomy. So with autonomy, I'm going to give you some examples of how some companies have done it, because so far there is no one technique. There are several approaches that you can use. So with autonomy on a grander scale, there is a company called Atlassian. And what Atlassian does is they give their staff, they say, you work for 365 days a year, but for 1 week of the year, will give you one day. And in that one day, you can do whatever you want, okay? In terms of working on projects. You can do whatever you want in within the company, use the company resources, whatever, but with one condition. At the end of that day, you show us what you have created. You show us what you worked on. And as a result, Atlassian has had engineers, software engineers, all of these people, spend that one day on their own. Just suka je on their own. And they have come up with multiple products that that the company can sell. So the engineers actually have one day that they can work on their coding, their software, on any project that they want. And they've discovered, wow, this is amazing, because they managed to actually create products and services that are useful to the customers that they never thought about. So what they did, they increased that to more and more days in a year, not just one day per year. Google, on the other hand, has been doing this for a very, very long time. If you have a Gmail account, you will know that it's free. It's free by Google. But what you don't know is that it came out of a concept called Google Labs. And Google Labs says that for every day or every week you work, dedicate only 80% to doing your day-to-day Google work. But the other 20% of the day, you can do whatever you want. You can work on whatever project you want that's related to Google software. And you know what popped out of that? One of them was Gmail. One of the software engineers came up with Gmail, and he now owns stock in the company. He also owns part of the patent of Gmail. So whenever they earn through Gmail, he gets money as well. That's why in Google, even though the employees, there are quite a few employees who are millionaires. Millionaires because they hold patents, co-patents with Google, and they also have shares in Google. Shares that were given to them in lieu of paying for their patents, for their ideas. Gmail came out of that. Google Drive came out of that. Google Docs, Google Spreadsheet, Google Sheets, what is the PowerPoint one? Google Slides. All of that came out of their people experimenting 20% of their time. 80% is day-to-day work. So when they're not promised money, but they're promised autonomy, and then they create something that is valuable, then the money comes, right? Not the money up front. So Google Labs is still alive and is still producing. I'll give you one example that's closer to home. I worked on a project in 2005, 2006, I think about that. It's been about 15 years already, I think. In Petronas Penapisan Terengganu. And Petronas Penapisan Terengganu, we worked with the CEO at the time. His name is Kamarudin Zakaria. He's now retired from Petronas. He was a former vice president of Petronas Corporate. We worked with him to help change the culture within PPT. And we wanted that culture to be a health-oriented culture. Because it's stressful working in oil and gas. So we wanted to change their perception, change their ideas about health and fitness. So of course we did some wellness training, we did some tests, UKJK tests, stuff like that. But really what turned the tide was the policies themselves. So on Tuesdays and Thursdays, it would be a no lift day. You don't use the elevator on those days. Yeah. So Tuesdays and Thursdays, if you are pregnant, you use the lift. They recommended to everyone, if you're not carrying heavy stuff and stuff like that, to go up and down. There was only 3 floors anyway in the building. This is not KL, this is Terengganu, by the way. They have a lot of space to build. Tuesdays and Thursdays were non-lift days. And it was slow to begin with, but after a few months, people started getting the hang of it. And people were actually getting excited. Come, let's see who can get there faster. Even the older generation were very excited because they can feel themselves getting stronger and stronger. Okay, that's one part. The one that really pushed it over the edge is the CEO said, okay, every day, you can leave at 4 o'clock. But if you decide to leave at 4 o'clock, you must spend that extra hour, 4 to 5, in the gym. No, not leave. You can stop work at 4 o'clock. You can stop work at 4 o'clock and you have an extra hour again. That extra hour, you must spend in the gym. And they built a huge, fantastic gym for them. And what happened was, slowly, trickle, people was like, okay, I tak tahan lah, kerja lagi dah hari ni, I think I'll stop now lah. Stop at 4 o'clock and they would go to the gym. And what happened was, when they went to the gym, they chose to go to the gym, it improved their physical experience, and then the next day they would be better, they would be happier to go to work, and it creates a cycle. The stronger your body is, the easier it is for you to think, your brain is supported, they can do work faster. So they found that they actually finished work at 4 o'clock, they had nothing else to do. Try, dulu-dulu, masa mula-mula, of course, they couldn't get it done by 5. They had to like 5:30 or 6 o'clock, they had to stay back. But now they were consistently finishing work by 4, which means it is possible, everyone, for all of us here, to actually work 6 hours a day, not even 5 hours, because not even 8 hours or 7 hours. Why? Because what we're doing is just wasting a lot of time. So PPT proved that you could finish at 4 and then go to the gym, become stronger physically and go the next day and want to do the work. So these are things that you can implement at a company level or even at an individual level. Okay, so this there's also now non-company related. This is a results-only work environment, which is a movement globally to try and shift away from the traditional British punch in, punch out, clock in, clock out model, where instead of focusing on what you need to do, you focus on what you need to deliver. And as I mentioned just now, my company before this actually implemented this. If you finish your work, balik, don't stay. Don't waste electricity, don't waste internet, go home. Okay. So we focus on a results-only work environment. I know it's scary for some, or it's not used to some of your work, but this is the trend. It's changing companies very fast, and we do hope to see in 10, 15 years at the most, more and more companies are like this, more results-only work. And the last one, example of autonomy, which is interesting, that is not even employees, is Wikipedia. Now, Wikipedia, I don't think is accepted as a scholarly resource, but a lot of people use it. And nobody who contributes to Wikipedia gets paid. All of the writers, all of the editors, they do it for free. Nobody actually does it for payment. So how do you practice autonomy within your department, within your organization? Well, first, you need to identify at a small level, as an individual leader or as an individual lecturer, identify by asking, getting to know your people, who is more autonomy oriented, who is, you know, not, how do you know? Because they don't come to you to ask you whether this is correct or not. They would rather finish everything and then give to you. So if you find someone like this, don't micromanage them. This is the worst person to micromanage. They will hate you forever, but give them trust. It is only when they break that trust, then you can take it back. So be verbal about it. You can say, I notice that you work very well on your own. You don't need a lot of supervision. Is that true? Is that your preference? And if they say yes, you say, okay, I'm going to test out something with you. I'm going to give you more independence, right? Which means I'm going to trust you with the work. And if you do the work well, then I will trust you to do the work more. But if you don't, then I will need to come in and supervise you more often. Do you agree to that? And if they say, okay, I agree, then you try this out. And I've done this with a few people. And of course, there's the plus and the minus. The plus ones, the good ones, I no longer have to supervise them. Sometimes they ask me a lot of questions about the, you know, what's the expectation? What should it look like? Can you give me an example? Can you give me a template? Things like that. Which means that they don't want to bother me throughout the task. So they'll ask a lot of questions up front. So that's a plus. And they do the work and I trust them and they come back perfect and sometimes above and beyond my expectation. The minus, sometimes you get people who want autonomy but are not ready for it. So with these people, you need to be very, very open and discuss and say, do you want me to not micromanage you? And if they say yes, please don't micromanage me. And you can say, okay, however, since I'm responsible in this department, I'm responsible for the output, I need to make sure that it gets done according to quality. So let's do this step by step, okay? This week, I'm going to test you. I'm going to give you a bit of autonomy and let's see what happens. I'll give you a bit of independence. And if you don't perform according to the KPI, according to what's set, then I'm going to come back and mentor you some more. Would you agree to that? And if they say yes, that means they've tied themselves in already. So you now have a performance loop that you can use. If they do well, you let them a bit more, a bit more, a bit more, until you see that they can run on their own. But if they don't do well, then you say, okay, as I've mentioned, because you did not meet this, now I'm going to come in, I'm going to help you. Okay? They might not like it, but they've agreed to it. All right. That was autonomy. What questions do you have on autonomy? Please ask me now. If you have no questions, give me an N in the text chat. You've noticed I've been talking a bit slowly. It's because these might be new concepts. So I'm giving you time to understand it. What questions do you have? Please ask me in the text chat. No questions? All right. Thank you, Vicky. Kejap, let me see. Oh, it still ends. Okay, let's go to purpose. Here, I want to ask you questions, so you have to give me answers. Let's say when we talk about purpose and we say that there are people out there who are motivated intrinsically, they are motivated from the inside. They're not motivated from the outside. So I'm going to give you a few case studies and I want you to tell me what do you think I'll give you a few case studies, things that have actually happened. I want you to tell me which one of these interventions worked more, worked better. So, for example, there is one instance where a hospital was trying to reduce the rates of infections in their patients, because the rate of infections kept getting high, and they discovered it was because of cross-contamination. One doctor or one nurse would inspect a patient, and then without washing their hands, without cleaning, disinfecting, go to another patient and then cross-contaminate that patient. So they become infected from other patients. So what did they do? They tried a few things. They experimented with a few things. The first one is they put up signages all across the hospital. They put signages at the sinks where you're supposed to wash your hand. And the signage says, hand hygiene prevents you from catching diseases. That was the first one they put. And then they tested in other parts of the hospital. They put this, hand hygiene prevents patients from catching diseases. And in other parts of the hospital, they went a bit flighty, a bit philosophical. Gel in, wash out. Now, 1, 2, 3. Please tell me which one do you think worked? 1, 2, or 3? Which one actually worked in helping the staff become more compliant, become more committed to washing their hands? Take a look at all three and then tell me which one do you think worked? 1, 2, or 3? Okay, Vicky says 1. One. Keep going. Azin says 1. Everyone else? Dr. Farida, Dr. Artini, Dr. Hairul, Dr. Azlina, Dr. Azam, Dr. Lisa, what are your answers? What do you think? Okay, the title says 2. Thank you. Any more? Which do you think worked? Okay, Dr. Lisa says 3. Thank you. Keep going. Let's see how many answers we can get from everyone. We've got 3 votes for 1, 1 vote for 2, 1 vote for 3. Five, four, three, two, one. So right now we have 3 votes for 1, 2 votes for number 2, and 1 vote for number 3. Okay, let's start with number 3 first. Gel in, wash out. Wow, this one is a campaign. My question to you, how many campaigns have you actually seen work? Because campaigns tend to be very very flighty, very philosophical. they tend to be very high level. And high level campaigns spend a lot of money to make pretty posters, pretty signages. So from your experience in Malaysia, I think you've seen that a lot of government campaigns, they don't have the kind of impact that we want. Why? Because sometimes it's just too generic, it's too non-specific. Between one and two, we found that, I can definitely tell you, number three did not work. Number three did not help reduce the infection rate at all in that part of the hospital. Between number one makes sense, right? Hand hygiene prevents you from catching diseases, sure. Second one also makes sense. Hand hygiene prevents patients from catching diseases. But between number one and number two actually got more traction, actually got more people to be more compliant and committed. You know why? Because they discovered most people who join the medical profession want to help. They're not there for the want to help people become better. A lot of them had childhood traumas where they saw their parents pass away from cancer, or they had a sister who was afflicted with a rare disease or something like that. When you ask a doctor, you ask a nurse, right? Only a few will say, I wanted to go into this because it's a good career to have. But when they surveyed the nurses and the doctors in the hospital, they discovered most of them were purpose-oriented. So that explained why number two works best, because they don't care about catching diseases. They're in hospital, they get treatment for free, but they do care about causing other people to get diseases. So the second one worked well, and they cascaded across hospitals everywhere else. It tells them hand hygiene prevents patients from catching diseases because you could help them catch disease, so you must wash your hands. All right, let's take a look at the second one. Undergrads raise study fund for alumni. So in America, they sometimes do this. I don't know if they do it in Malaysia, but in America, what they do is they get the undergraduate students, maybe in their third or final year, to volunteer to call up alumni. Right? And they call up alumni to ask for donations to be able to fund the university, maybe fund the building of a new library, or fund a new section or a new department or something like that. I know we don't do that much in Malaysia, but over there they do. For the reason that Americans have a very connection to their universities, to their colleges. They feel indebted, they feel, they have a strong emotional connection. So if you are an alumni of a particular university, you're very proud of that. So what they do is they get the undergrads in their third or final year to call up the alumni and ask for donations. So they experimented, they wanted to see how could we drive these undergrads to make more calls and get more donations. Because the more calls you make, the more donations you get. That was the correlating factor. So what they did was, number one, they did nothing. They didn't brief the volunteers. All they said, okay, this is the name list, please call and please get them to volunteer to donate. That's what they did. One. And then they tested on another control group. They gave the undergrads letters from former students who worked at the call center. Okay? They read real letters from former students who worked at the call center. So for example, if I were volunteered this year to call up the alumni and I did a good job, and I would and my boss says, okay, to help motivate the next year punya students, can you please write a letter to them and tell them what are some of your best practices, some of your tips and tricks, tell them what was your experience here. So, okay, I write the letter, and then they keep the letter, and 2021, a new group of volunteers come in, and we give them the letters to read. And then you say, hi, my name is Nazrin, I was a volunteer just like you last year, and I had a really great time in this call center, so let me share with you my experience, and blah, 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 blah. They gave another group those letters to read. And they gave a third group of volunteers letters from beneficiaries of the fund. So in this case, the fund is actually gone to help students with, from poor backgrounds to join the university. This is what the fund is, why they're calling. They're calling from the students who got these scholarships. So if I, as a volunteer, I come in and my boss gives me these letters, the letter maybe comes from a student from Perak, right? I would like to thank the fund for giving me the opportunity to study, because now I've graduated and I'm actually able to have a good career. I can take care of my parents. I'm married, I'm having kids, and I'm really happy. So thank you very much for giving us the opportunity, giving me the opportunity to study. So my question, thank you, Dr. Hasnina, no worries. My question, please tell me, between the first, second, and third, which one do you think worked on getting the undergrads to call more? Which one do you think worked to get the undergrads to call more and have get more donations? One, two, or three? What do you think? Tell me in the text chat. One, two, or three? No worries, Dr. Farida. Thank you for coming. Vignesh says three. Vicky says three. Any more? Which do you think worked? Okay, we got votes for three. Two votes for three. I think you're learning this already. Thank you very much. So three votes for three. Four votes for three. Okay lah. Menang lah tu, dah tahu lah. You are right. When they did nothing, the number of calls was very, very low. When they gave the letters from former students, the numbers were higher. But when they gave the letters from beneficiaries of the fund, the numbers were significantly higher. Why? Because the undergrads who volunteered to do the calls did not volunteer for mastery or autonomy or stewardship. They volunteered because they thought they could actually help someone. And reading really motivated them to be able to speak to the alumni. And in fact, they now have case studies that they can share with the alumni. So that is someone with a purpose orientation. Now, I'm going to share my story in becoming a professional learning facilitator. I am not a trainer by the definition of the term. As a professional learning facilitator, my job is to make it easy for people to learn. The word facilitator means make easy. Learning means learn, right? So as a professional learning facilitator, I do it to help people learn. Now, do I do it for the money? I don't. I earn a living as a professional learning facilitator, but this is not why I do it. Do I do it for the fame? The fame comes because compared to lecturers, so there's pros and cons. As a lecturer, you get to see your students grow over 14 weeks. I love that. I love that my students are on Facebook with me and they're still contacting me and they're still telling me about their jobs, about their marriage, about their family. I love that. Yeah. But as a trainer in the corporate world, you don't have that kind of interaction. It's mostly hit and run, right? You meet people for 2 days and then you don't know what happens next. So the fame is a bit muted there. But what I do it for is I do it for the family. I do it for my family because I want to help other people, because I know other people are helping my children. I teach at the corporate level to help people to learn better, to be able to do their work better, because I want them to be better for their work, for their families. And because I know other people are doing the same for my children, for my family as well. When I send my kids to school, the teachers there are doing it for me. So I want to do it for other people as well. This is my purpose. So my question, I guess, is you have to ask yourself why you're doing something. Okay. And if you're driven by more, if you go like, okay, this is nice, but I'm more driven by mastery. Nothing wrong with that. Absolutely nothing wrong with that. Therefore, you also cannot judge your staff or your students. There are some people who just want to make dean's list. There are some people who say, Allah, I get the degree, I can still do the work well. Yeah. Dapat dean's list pun, not much difference. What later on when I get job, I'll still be going up against smart people. But how well I do in the interview is what matters. Yeah, because not everyone with a dean's list gets a job. So some people think like that. They think more mastery, or more autonomy, or more purpose. Now we come to the last part of today, which is stewardship. And with stewardship, there are no techniques except understanding people who want to leave a legacy behind. And where did I learn about stewardship? I learned it at this company called Accenture when I was working for about 7 years. And Accenture has stewardship as one of its core values. Yeah, there are six core values. Let me try to remember. Client value creation, one global network, respect for the individual, best people, integrity, and stewardship. And stewardship means we want to leave the planet a little bit better than when we arrived on it. And Accenture has amazing, application of core values. You know, some companies, when they have core values, the core values are sitting on the wall. They're not sitting in people's hearts. They are not being practiced by the company. But I was amazed, and I'm telling you right now, I was not brainwashed by Accenture because I joined Accenture as an experienced hire. That means I was 29 years old. I was already quite old by the time I joined Accenture. So tak sempat they brainwashed me from the beginning of my career. When I came in, I was quite skeptical because people were saying, you know, in Accenture, when you need help, you just email anybody in Accenture, they will help you. I'm saying, yeah, girl. So I tested it out. My first day on the job, I emailed someone in my position in Chicago and I said, hi, I just joined the company and I'm not too sure what I'm supposed to be doing. There's so much to process, so much to read. Can you give me some tips? And I wrote the email at 9 o'clock when I was on my first day at work. My first day at work was 3rd March 2008. I remember this date. And I thought, okay, I'll just wait a couple of days for the reply to come back. No. Within 2 hours, that means this person was typing in Chicago at about 11 p.m. at night. I got a reply and said, thank you very much, Nazrin, for reaching out to me. Congratulations, welcome to the company. However, I'm no longer in that position that you are now. That means the website was not properly updated. She is now in a new position. But she says, tell you what, let me introduce you to a few people. She copies the email with a few other people and she introduces me to her colleagues in St. Charles in Chicago. And I was blown away. And I thought, this is ridiculous. Why are these people doing it? Because they're practicing stewardship. They believe that they can help me become a better employee through their actions. So Accenture has, amongst all companies in the world, and I've double-checked this, amongst all the companies in the world, has the highest budget for learning and development, for training their staff, has the highest budget allocated. When I left the company in 2015, the budget, or the last number I saw was $800 million annually for all their staff. 800 million. That's a lot of money to put into training. Whereas a lot of companies in Malaysia, training is a cost. It's a budget. Habis duit, habis lah. Okay? And it's a very small budget for their staff. You have to really fight to be able to get it. But Accenture puts, they say people are their assets. So they develop their assets by developing the people. There's also other things that they do, something called Accenture Development Partnerships. The ADP is, and they understand their people very well. Eh? They understand that not everybody wants to do work for clients that are big, like, you know, ExxonMobil or BHP Billiton, wow, Petronas. They want to make impacts in other ways. So they created something called the ADP, where Accenture would work with NGOs like Oxfam, WWF, which is for animals, ActionAid, WeCare, all of these NGOs and foundations around the world. What are NGOs? NGOs were founded by people who have a noble cause, but they're not very good at management. They're not very good at budgeting sometimes, and then the money that they receive, they don't know how to spend properly. So they don't have management skills. So what ADP does is it takes consultants who don't want to work in the industry anymore, sometimes because of work-life balance or because of burnout, they're just bored. They can actually take 3 months to a year off their projects and go and work with an NGO, sometimes in Africa, sometimes in Southeast Asia, right? Especially those from America. And they get to experience working outdoors. Yeah, they have their laptop, but they're still working outdoors. What are they doing? They help organizations to become more efficient using their consulting knowledge. But there's a replacement as well. Because NGOs cannot afford the kind of consulting fees that Accenture charges, so you have to contribute 50% of your salary as a pay cut, but you'll be given accommodation and food throughout the year. Right? So they have this, And a lot of people, especially single people with no spouses, no children, have gone for the ADP, and it has enriched their lives because they've actually built better supply chains, better financial management for these companies, for these organizations. This is where I work, and this is the Learning Center for Accenture. This is the lounge, of course. I don't have pictures of the classroom. I can show you sometime, but I guess this is the last time we meet. But I'm saying that this is where I spent 7 years of my life practicing stewardship. Because what is stewardship? It is building the future. And participants from all over the world, all over 500,000 staff of Accenture, would come to learn. And I would manage that with the faculty, with the participants, with the administration. And it was every single day. It was every single day. But then my stewardship became a bit too much, and I forgot about work-life balance. I forgot about my family for a while. So I'm saying to you right now, if stewardship is also your deal, stewardship can actually take you away from other important things in your life and some of your staff also. So you want to find that balance. What they do in Malaysia, they have something called the Skills to Succeed Academy, where we actually, I'm still using the word we, where they dedicate their consultants' resources to help students in the rural areas in Malaysia, students who want to learn faster. So we dedicate our learning and development expertise to help them with their memorization skills, to help them with their study skills, to help them understand how to study, how to learn faster, and things like that. So they've set this up. It's been quite a bit success. But because Accenture in Malaysia is a small company, they are still going process school by school by school. And that is stewardship. So my question to you before we end today is, let's just say stewardship is something you want to focus on, right? What would you want to build? What would you want to leave behind after you leave this planet? And it doesn't have to be in the case of something very big. It can be something very, very small. So what would be your practice of stewardship? While you are thinking and typing, I'll share mine. I currently head a community of virtual educators. There are about 250 of them, I think now 300, from 18 different countries. And we started this year. That's why the number is small. We started this year in March or April, just around the time pandemic came about. And I don't know use the word lead, but I guide this community to be able to grow their skills in teaching online. So the community is called the Virtual LearnCaster community, or the Virtual LearnCaster family, the VLC family. And Umu is part of it. So Umu here is part of it, Dr. Amira is part of it. And day to day, I see them grow. I see them getting jobs from clients where they teach using virtual technology. And every single day, I feel happier and happier and happier. Why? Because I get to see them grow. And I know you, especially the lecturers in this room right now, I know you know what it feels like, because after 14 weeks, you get to see someone succeed, and then you start the process all over again. So now my last question to you before we finish for this morning is, what do you want to leave behind after you are gone? And I'm going to give you 2 minutes to do this. So please think very carefully. What do you want to leave behind before you are gone? Umu, what about you? What do you want to leave behind? Some people say, Adazri, we're talking about dying. Well, no, I'm not talking about dying. I'm talking about what do you want to impact to this planet. On the day of judgment, what can you say that you have done to have left the planet and the people on the planet a little bit better than when you arrived on the planet?
I mean, I'm not keen of big changes.
That's okay. I'm not asking for big changes. I'm just asking for changes.
Yeah. I guess mine is more to the environment. Like, because I prefer to walk and using public transport instead of driving and everything. I mean, just the little things. that hopefully will make our earth a little bit healthier than before.
Did you finish? Because I thought that was a question. Okay, thank you very much.
I mean,
okay, so that sounds more like a purpose. For it to become stewardship, how can you multiply that? Can you make a club? Can you build a club, or can you write a book or an ebook that many, many people will read? Purpose and stewardship is purpose, you can run it alone. But stewardship, you can influence a lot of other people to follow in your footsteps as well.
Right, currently, I'm just attaching myself to WWF and do the best I can joining their program.
Any more?
For now, it's just that. I hope that I can do much better in years coming.
Thank you very much for that. Thank you very much for doing this. So my suggestion, Umo, is you have your social media, you have your Facebook or your Instagram or LinkedIn or things like that, right?
Now
we actually have, as human beings, more opportunity to practice stewardship even more, because we now have media. So my suggestion is, if you want to be even more fulfilled, not just from a purpose perspective, start sharing this with your friends, and then tell them it's actually easy to do. Okay, if all of us just stop doing this, okay, we will make an impact. Okay, today we stop doing this. Next week we stop doing this. Next week we start doing this, for example. So I'm saying that you can actually make a difference. And Umo, I'm talking to you as a friend, right?
Yes.
You were here very early on when we started the VLC family.
Yes.
Now that you look at the VLC family, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I'm surprised at how big it grows.
I am surprised.
Yeah.
I didn't expect this to happen.
Yeah, and I am surprised that we are helping each other to you know, seek for new opportunities.
Yes.
Yeah.
And if you imagine that there are 250 of them,
right,
and every one of them have 30 participants.
Right, right.
Maybe every day. How many people are we impacting?
Very, very much.
So now I'm asking you to think about that for yourself as well. How can you impact more people to be more go green, to be more energy conscious, to have a lower carbon footprint, to you know, recycle at home, to have less waste produced at home, things like that? You can impact a lot of people. All you have to do is just use the power of your social media.
Right.
Thank you very much. Dr. Hyrule says, I wish I can leave behind one good legacy that can be continued by future generations. Special DNA for UM students. I believe you. I believe you can do that. Right now, it sounds more like a purpose. So, Dr. Hyrule, is there a program that you can create? A training program, an event that, you know, all students can have to go through, or all students in your faculty have to go through before they graduate, for example. Not a bridging program, but something that can leave an impact on them. Okay, so some in IIUM, in UIA, the engineering faculty has a program called, Start Your Engines, because engineering, it's called Start Your Engines. It's not a bridging program, but final year students go for this intensive 2-day course to be able to quickly ramp up their critical thinking skills, their people skills, their decision-making skills, and their self-motivation. So it has processed quite a few engineers by now. Other faculties don't do it except for the engineering faculty. And that's because I am friends with the dean, and we run this program together. So the idea is, can you multiply? If you can multiply, then it becomes stewardship. If you're running it alone, then it's still purpose. Thank you, Dr. Hyrule. And Dr. Fazlin, I want to leave a bit of my best practices at work and my habit for people around me or know me to apply in their life. Fantastic. So you had, number one is, of course, practice by leadership by example. The second one is actually teach them how to teach other people. So it doesn't just stay at one level. Create a multi-level marketing hierarchy of the people you impact also impacting other people. And if you can think about it that way, wow, I think you would be far more motivated to build something more legacy that is self-sustainable. When you're gone, it runs on its own. So that's all I have for you today. Thank you very much, everyone. If you have questions, please ask me now. If you have no questions, give me an N so I know to finish up this morning. Right? So give me an N so I know that we're done and you have no more questions. And while I'm waiting for that answer, I would like to say thank you very much to Umu for hosting this. Thank you, everyone who came. I hope you got something that you can take home. I hope you got something that you can use. And if you need to talk to me some more, you can find me on the internet. My name is Muhammad Nazrin Wahab. I am probably the only person on this planet still with that name. Nobody, if you Google my name, you will find it. There's nobody else on this planet so far. Alhamdulillah. Even when I was at Accenture, in 500,000 people, nobody had my name. Therefore, my email address was very, very unique. So thank you very much, everyone. And I'm going to hand this back to Umu. Have a good day. Have a good weekend and stay safe and healthy. InsyaAllah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
All right. Waalaikumsalam. Thank you, everyone. So I hope we can meet back here at 2:30 p.m. for our next topic. Okay. Enjoy your lunch. Thank you.
All right. See some of you at 2:30. I know not everyone will come back. We might get new participants as well. So for those coming back, we'll see you at 2:30. Bye-bye, everyone.